Glinda's Games!
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Gin here with another League of Legends Champion Guide. Children can be scary, can't they? They seem so fragile, and yet they can often be just as competent as miniature adults. Well, they're extra scary when you give them dark magical powers and a penchant for setting things on fire. None more so than Annie, the Dark Child. She'll light your world ablaze and end it before you realize what's going on. Join me now. It's time to learn How to Annie. Annie is a short-ranged ability power mage, adept at assassinating single and sometimes multiple targets in a matter of seconds. She brings stuns and extremely high damage to the table, both single target and AoE, but is fairly weak when her abilities are down and is quite squishy. She's a perfect fit for mid lane, farming easily while harassing enemy mages and eventually making them explode, shutting them down before they have the chance to start rolling. Now, you might be asking me at this point, as we begin, Gin, why should I play Annie? She's slow, she's squishy, she has no escapes, her utility is low. Let me break it down for you. This is your Vayne. This is your Vayne on fire. Any questions? Now, before we get to her abilities, we must first make special note of Annie's basic attack. Unlike most mages, hers is quite long-ranged, the second longest in the game, currently behind Caitlyn. This is hugely significant. While her spell range is shorter than most mages, it means she can constantly poke them for free while they can do nothing about it without wasting mana. Be sure to mix in auto-attacks against your enemies whenever you can while laning. Keep them on their toes. Her passive is Pyromania. After every four spells cast, her next offensive spell will stun the target for 1.75 seconds in addition to its other effects. If that offensive spell does damage to multiple targets, it stuns everything it damages at the time. That 1.75 seconds, once she has her full combo, is easily enough for her to crush her target and still have time to skip off to the candy store. It's useful for both starting fights and escaping. Other than keeping track of the number of charges on your buff bar, you, and your enemies, will know when your stun is available by the small, swirling vortex that surrounds her, as well as her giggling when it comes online. We'll talk about Pyromania more as we move on. Annie's Q is Disintegrate. Not the magic spell that exiles a creature if it dies, but it might as well be. She tosses a single fireball at a target, dealing significant magic damage. If Disintegrate kills the target, the mana cost is refunded. This latter part makes it very useful for farming throughout the game, making her much less mana-dependent than other casters. This is important, as dropping her full combo on a target can be very expensive, so a spell that can be free if used properly is very useful. Its range is also exactly the same as her basic attack, so you can use it as a 1-2 punch of harassment against your enemies. In fact, if you have a stun up, you can get off multiple attacks to bring them down even more. For its awesome damage, cheapness, and ease of farming, be sure to max this one out as soon as possible. Little Firestarter's W is Incinerate. More fire-based damage. Surprise! This time she deals damage in a 45-degree cone to everything in front of her. If Pyromania is fully charged, as we mentioned earlier, she'll also stun every target. This is very useful for clearing waves of minions. If positioned properly, you can even harass your enemy at the same time. While Incinerate is a basic and simple damage spell, it has one special use case. Normally, you'll want to start off with Disintegrate in lane, but if you expect a level 1 teamfight or simply want to threaten an early stun, since it doesn't have a target, you can begin casting it in the fountain at the start of the game. In this way, you can have a spell ready to stun multiple targets right at the start, allowing your team to crush the enemy then and there. Generally speaking though, Incinerate is your secondary damage tool as it costs a lot more mana in general and can actually miss, being a skill shot and all. For all these reasons, max it out second. Next is Annie's only non-offensive spell, Molten Shield. It places a shield around her for 5 seconds, increasing her armor and magic resistance. In addition, it also deals magic damage to any enemy that uses a basic attack against her, similar to the item Thornmail. While obviously this is useful in a fight, helping her to escape safely once she's dropped her combo and providing a little extra poke against carries that focus her, primarily it is useful as a way to charge up Pyromania without expending a lot of mana or potentially wasting it. In fact, it only costs 20 mana at all ranks. For this, take a point in it early, like level 4 and max it out last. Lastly, for the ultimate, we get to the bear that the little girl keeps babbling on about. Yes, that's right! At last, it's time to summon Tibbers. It does just what it says on the tin, dropping the giant shadow bear like a nuke from orbit and dealing massive magic damage to everything around him. For the next 45 seconds, Tibbers is a controllable pet, with his own attack damage, health, armor, and magic resistance. He also has a fire aura around him, dealing constant damage to everything near him each second, in addition to whatever he swipes at. While he's around, Tibbers can be controlled by either holding the Alt key and right-clicking a location, or by pressing R, in which case he will move wherever your cursor points, where he will attempt to attack the closest enemy in range. For massive area damage and a controllable pet, you can bet that you should take a point and summon Tibbers every chance you can. When playing Annie, we want to make things explode as quickly as possible. At the same time, we want to ensure that she has enough mana to drop a full combo when the time comes, and to shore up some of her tankiness issues. To this end, we take 2109 masteries, for maximum ability power, and some points in utility for cooldowns, mana, speed, and runic affinity to keep blue buff longer should we get it. If you're good at managing your mana though, especially with Disintegrate, you could very easily skip it and exchange it for something else, like Biscuitier. For runes, I take Magic Penetration Marks, Mana Regeneration per level Seals, Ability Power per level Glyphs, and Flat Ability Power Quintessences. Those Seals, again if you're good at managing mana, can be traded in for yet more Scaling Ability Power. I chose Scaling Ability Power Glyphs and Seals because they begin to surpass the flat ones at levels 6 and 7 respectively, which is conveniently just after she gains Tibbers and starts to dominate. We'll talk about that a little more later. The Quintessences, on the other hand, don't catch up until level 12, which is far too late for my tastes. Summoner spells are simple. Flash and Ignite. The first gets you in range for your surprise Rain of Death and Bears. It's also an escape tool too if you need it. The second makes things burn more. You might have noticed a bit of a theme here. Annie can begin the game a number of different ways for items, either with a Doran's Ring, Boots of Speed, or Crystalline Flask. All of these can be accompanied with your choice assortment of health potions and or wards. The ring will provide extra damage should you think you have a strong matchup in addition to some basic regeneration. Boots you'll be getting at some point anyway and allow you to dodge skill shots better. The Crystalline Flask is a purely defensive option should you believe that you will have a difficult matchup. When returning to base the first time, hopefully you can purchase a Catalyst the Protector. This should solve any sustained problems you had before and allow you to rush for a Rod of Ages as quickly as possible. This is an amazing item on Annie, letting her escape more easily once her combo has been dropped and providing excellent damage during the main game. The earlier you can get it, the better. Generally speaking though, if you have passed the 20-minute mark in the game, you should skip it. After that point, it quite possibly won't get to full power before the game is over, and won't provide you quite as many levels worth of sustain. After that, it's damage time. Your boots will of course become Sorcerer's Shoes. Rabadon's Death Cap is an excellent choice in case her whittle head gets cold, or she makes it start raining blood. As a burst caster, the Death Cap is pretty much essential, and in fact, if you feel comfortable without the safety of Rod of Ages, you should rush for this first. Its raw damage is gold efficient even without other items to give it bonus AP. Deathfire Grasp is an excellent item to make your combo even more powerful. Not only does it deal significant damage itself, it makes your other spells more powerful against the target. The Morellonomicon makes it very difficult for targets you deal damage to recover. Void Staff gives you magic penetration in case the enemy thinks they can hide behind defenses. Speaking of defenses, should you need more yourself, there are two excellent options for Annie. Abyssal Scepter gives magic resistance while reducing that of your enemies, stacking well with your magic penetrating items. While the aura's range is short, it's long enough to encompass Annie's spells. For armor, there is Zhonya's Hourglass, which lets you be invincible too, not to mention giving you a ton more ability power. Now that we've discussed the basics, let's talk about Annie's combo. Whenever possible, it should begin by summoning Tibbers with Pyromania ready to stun the target. If you have them, nail the target with Deathfire Grasp and Ignite, and of course, follow up with Disintegrate followed by Incinerate. The cooldown on Disintegrate is very short, so using it early might allow you to use it again should they somehow escape the inferno of death and teddy bears you've dropped on them. Pyromania can be easily charged up without enemies even being around, using a combination of Incinerate and Molten Shield. Molten Shield can even let you be quite sneaky here. Your opponents only see the Stun is Up particle at 4 charges. If you sit on 3, you can activate Molten Shield right before dropping your combo to get a sudden, unexpected stun. You can, alternatively, use a fully charged Pyromania to play mind games with your enemy. No sane enemy wants to be near Annie if her stun is up, just in case she decides to melt their faces off after all. You can use this to your advantage, forcing them to run from you and miss farm while pelting them with auto attacks. It's important to remember that Tibbers is an allied minion for all intents and purposes. He can be healed with spells or buffed with items such as Aegis of the Legion, but he can also be targeted like minions for negative effects like Smite and Nunu's Consume. You should also remember that he is fully controllable and doesn't have to go the same place as Annie. You can move him around corners to flank for you, sit him in a bush to stand guard, or place him in front of you to tank turrets or block skill shots. He is, unfortunately, not all that fast, so he won't necessarily be able to keep up or escape easily. He also won't be able to go harass the other side of the map for you, as he does have a leash range. You can use that leash to your advantage, though. If Tibbers isn't keeping up with you, send him in the opposite direction. The leash will cause him to teleport back to where Annie is. Annie's power curve is quite interesting as a burst mage. In the early game, she's about the same as anyone else, but once she hits level 6 and has access to her spells, she can fairly easily instantly kill anyone she chooses. She remains quite powerful throughout the mid-game, but the later the game goes and the more defenses her enemies acquire, the weaker she becomes. The competent Annie player should seek to win the game as early as possible. Gank often, especially past level 6. If you have Tivers available, always seek to get a kill, whenever you can. Help out weak lanes or strengthen ones that are steamrolling. In teamfights, Annie's job is to find a squishy target and kill it, preferably the AD carry. She may die in the process, but if the enemy's main damage dealer is gone, she's done her job well. If they've decided to all cluster together, she's even happier as she can drop Tibbers and Incinerate on multiple targets. Doing so will ensure your team nearly 2 seconds of free reign to clean up the enemy. Time your combos properly, and your enemies will quickly be beaten by a little girl. With that, thanks for watching! If you have enjoyed this guide, please let me know by hitting the like button. Speak up in the comments below if you have advice or questions. We're all here to learn. Subscribe for future content, including champion guides, gameplay guides, and other possibly not LOL content. Follow me on Twitch for streams, and Twitter and Facebook to see what else is going on. Till next time, I've been Gin, and you've been watching me talk about a video game. What's your favorite Aminor?
Dear Summoner, I was so excited when you finally picked me. Even while your teammates were begging you to jungle with Zen or Masyi. Clicked my portrait and took your time to choose all the perfect masteries. Even had a rune page set up that you named specifically after me. I know the last time you picked me we didn't do that great. But I've been buffed since then, and your scores have really improved of late. You learned how to bait, and your last hitting seems first rate. I can't believe this loading screen is taking so long, I really can't wait. I like your choice.